Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. We're just about to have our prelude, so if you want to relax, which means stop talking, and we'll prepare our minds and hearts for worship in a few minutes.
Thank you.
Well, once again, hello and welcome to church this morning. I have a number of notices, announcements that I need to make. 10th Women's Lunch is today at 12:30 in Fellowship Hall. All ladies are welcome to attend. Men have not been invited at all. Please join us this evening if you're coming for a hymn sing before the evening service at 6:15. The congregation are encouraged to select their favourite hymns from the Trinity Hymnal. We have three more parish meetings left. We had the Metro Parish meeting this week past. This week on Wednesday, May 18th, 6:30 at Delaware County Christian School, we have the Brandywine and Western Suburbs parishes combined. Thursday, 26th of May at 7:15, New Jersey at Covenant Press in Cherry Hill, and Northern Tier, June the 2nd at 6:30 at Westminster Seminary. Those are the coming attractions. Sad news this morning. Robert Carwithen, who was an organist and choir master at 10th, has died, and there will be a memorial in July. There'll be a private funeral and a memorial service in July. Robert was one of the kindliest and loveliest men you would ever meet. And our sister Sonia Spragans has lost her mother just the other day. So be praying for Signe and the family, and for those relatives of Robert's as well. Well, we've come to worship God, and this morning I want to read from 1 Chronicles chapter 29. Let's hear the word of God. Therefore David blessed the Lord in the presence of all the assembly. And David said, "Blessed are you, O Lord, the God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty, for all that is in the heavens and in the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head over all. Both riches and honor come from you, and you rule over all. In your hand are power and might, and in your hand it is to make great and to give strength to all. And now we thank you, our God, and praise your glorious name." Let's stand together. Glory, and we now confess our sin to him together. Let's all pray. O Lord, you are great and greatly to be praised. Forgive us for failing to glorify you as we ought, for half-hearted devotion, for speaking your name lightly, in establishing competing priorities, by allowing our sinful affections to dominate our thoughts, by not loving our neighbor as ourselves. Holy Father, please forgive our trespasses and grant us the renewing grace of your Holy Spirit. Through Christ our Savior we pray. Amen. Lift up your heads and receive these words of pardon and assurance. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward them who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgression from us. Let's pray. And it's with joy, Father, we come to you as we hear your words of pardon. As sinners as we are, we know that to be the case. We sin against one another as well as against you. We thank you that your word speaks gracious absolution and assurance into our minds and hearts. We thank you that our Lord Jesus lives and reigns and is our advocate in heaven. His very presence there is the assurance that we need that we will one day be with him where he is. Draw near to us now as we worship. We pray in his strong name. Amen.
This morning's responsive reading is from Psalm 31, which you can find in your bulletins. Please be seated. After which we'll stand to sing the Gloria Patri, followed by the Nicene Creed. Psalm 31. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for I am in distress. My eye is wasted from grief, and my soul and my body also. For my life is spent with sorrow, and my years with sighing. My strength fails because of my iniquity, and my bones waste away. Because of all my adversaries, I have become a reproach, especially to my neighbors, and an object of dread to my acquaintances. Those who see me in the streets flee from me. I have been forgotten like one who is dead. I have become like a broken vessel. For I hear the whispering of many, terror on every side, as they scheme together against me, as they plot to take my life. But I trust in you, O Lord. I say, you are my God. My times are in your hand. Rescue me from the hand of my enemies and from my persecutors. Make your face shine on your servant. Save me in your steadfast love. O Lord, let me not be put to shame, for I call upon you. Let the wicked be put to shame. Let them go silently to Sheol. Let the lying lips be mute, which speak insolently against the righteous in pride and contempt. Oh, how abundant is your goodness, which you have stored up for those who fear you and work for those who take refuge in you, in the sight of the children of mankind. In the cover of your presence, you hide them from the plots of men. You store them in your shelter from the strife of tongues. Blessed be the Lord, for he has wonderfully shown his steadfast love to me when I was in a besieged city. I had said in my alarm, I am cut off from your sight. But you heard the voice of my pleas for mercy when I cried to you for help. Love the Lord, all you his saints. The Lord preserves the faithful, but abundantly repays the one who acts in pride. Be strong and let your heart take courage, all you who wait for the Lord. Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of the Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us and our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of the Father, and he shall come again with glory to judge the living and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated.
Let's gather up our prayers as we approach the Father together. Our great and our glorious God, we're reminded that you are the creator of everything, out of nothing, and that there is in existence not only you who have had existence from all eternity, but you have brought into existence this universe in which we find ourselves. And we come to you as your creatures, made things, in order we would recognize and bless and praise you for
the fact that you are the maker of heaven and earth, all things visible and invisible, the spiritual realm as well as the material realm, belong to you. And as we come to you, Lord, we come through Jesus Christ our Lord, he who is your only begotten Son from all eternity. And we come by the Holy Spirit, who is the Lord and giver of life, who has given us eternal life and will give us resurrection life on the last day. We come, Lord, bring ourselves as we are, with all the feebleness of our faith, the frailty of our human bodies, and very often our unwillingness or perhaps inability to always be trusting you. We come, Lord, to ask that today you would quicken our faith, that you would make it live, that you would stir it up, and that you would stir our minds and hearts up to the enjoyment of you, because you want us not only to glorify you, but to enjoy you forever. We pray that that joy would be suffused through our congregation this morning as we come together. As we come, Lord, you have bid us to thank you for all the good gifts that you've given to us, Lord, in our lives. Our very breath this morning, the fact that we're alive today, is a gift from you. And the way in which we got here this morning, the mode of transport that we found, that was a gift. And whatever we will eat during the day will be your gift. And whatever we wear at this moment is a gift from you. And the people we know, the friends we have, the love with which we are loved by others, these are all your profound gifts. And we bring to you, Lord, a world that's in rebellion against you, a world that is harmful to us and to others. I pray, Lord, for those who are going through periods of war at the moment. People of Ukraine come to mind especially. And with high-powered bombs, phosphorus bombs falling on their cities. I pray for the people, Lord, of Northern Sudan who've been going through a 20-year war. And we pray, Lord, for those in other parts of the world who have got localized war and violence. Lord, we pray for them that wars would cease to the ends of the earth and that the weapons of war would be turned to peaceful ends. We come, Lord, with our own business. You know our own heart. You know the things we have going in our lives, challenges we face, decisions that we must make. Friends that we are at odds with, perhaps, members of the family that no longer communicate with us, breakdowns in relationship, all those things that are there in the forefront of our minds that we find it very hard to concentrate when we come to church or even at home when we're on our own because they keep on intruding themselves to the front of our mind. You know, Lord, the worries we have with our health, perhaps, or for the worries we have for other people's health, members of our family, friends. You know, Lord, the concerns we have for the future, perhaps our own future, the future of our families, parents. We bring all of these things to you. You've told us to roll them all onto you because you care for us. Pray today, Lord, that you would give us a sense of believing as we come. Believing prayer, casting on you, our dear Lord, all our concerns. And as we come to you today, Lord, we come through our Lord Jesus, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let's pray for our offering. Lord God, it is our prayer that this morning our souls would find stillness, that in the praise of your name we would find rest. And this morning we pray that these offerings given would be an act of recognition and trust that indeed all things are in your hand, and so we have found a safe place for our souls to be at rest. Pray that you would bless these offerings, that your gospel may go forth in power to the ends of the earth. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Please be seated.
To take your Bible and turn with me to Revelation chapter 19. We're moving inexorably towards the end of perhaps the most difficult book in the Bible, and you've done very well to stay with the course. Revelation chapter 19. Let's hear the word of God. After this I heard what seemed to be the sound of a great multitude in heaven crying out, "Hallelujah! Salvation and glory and power belong to our God, for his judgments are true and just, for he has judged the great prostitute who corrupted the earth with her immorality and has avenged on her the blood of his servants." Once more they cried out, "Hallelujah! The smoke from her goes up forever and ever." And the 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and worshiped God, who is seated on the throne, saying, "Amen, hallelujah." And from the throne came a voice saying, "Praise our God, all you his servants, you who fear him, small and great." Then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters, like the sound of mighty peals of thunder, crying out, "Hallelujah! For the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exult and give him glory. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. For the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. And the angel said to me, write this, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true words of God. Then I fell down at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, you must not do that. I am a fellow servant with you and your brothers who hold to the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Well, we've seen, as we've gone through the book of Revelation, we've seen the movement back and forth from the heavenly perspective to the earthly perspective. We're very familiar with the earthly perspective because that's where we've lived all of our lives up to this moment. We're very familiar with the politics and the commerce, with the values, with the good things and the bad things that come along with living on earth and of mixing with men and women. And one of the things that we discovered as we've gone through the book of Revelation is that in the background there is this image, an analogy for the world that we live in, the world of interactions, the world of social media, the world of people, that constantly reminds us that the world in which we live is a fallen world. But while the devil and the beast reign, the earth is a sphere of deceit and illusion. This same John writes a little letter we know as 1 John. And in that letter he says this, we know that we are from God and that the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. And then he goes on to say, the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does the will of God abides forever. So he makes this great distinction. There's us and them. We don't like making distinctions between us and them. We know how that works at the racial level, or at a cultural level, or at a social level, or an educational level. And that usually involves disparaging the them and favoring the us. But there is, I think, with a humble spirit and a humble heart, a need for us to distinguish between us and them, because the Bible does. Jesus says to his people, in this world you will have trouble. If they hated me, they will hate you also. That's the way it goes. And so we've had this image of Babylon that we've been looking at. Babylon is a code word for the world system that we grew up in and that we live in today. The people of the world and the whole cultural, political, commercial, and industrial complex that provides us with so much, that contributes so much to our lives and our happiness, as well as the happiness of human beings in general, is nonetheless suffused with a spiritual darkness. The world system is possessed of a universal allergy to the God who is there. That's a reality. We're told in the Bible that people love darkness. We're told that they choose darkness instead of light. In Ephesians, it says that we people can be darkness, and that they are destined for outer darkness, Jesus says. It is this great dark entity that is the world system that is named Babylon in the book of Revelation, which is a book in symbols and codes. The world system as we know it, Babylon, is going to collapse one day. It's going to come to an end, utterly and forever. And that's what was described at the end of chapter 18. I want to read the last few verses of 18 to give you a sense that there is coming an end to the ordinary things in life. Everything that we know of as human beings in our life on planet Earth will come to a final end one day. That's the message. Let me read it to you. So will Babylon, that great city, be thrown down with violence and will be found no more. And the sound of harpists and musicians, of the flute players and trumpeters will be heard in her no more. And a craftsman of any craft will be found in you no more. And the sound of the mill will be heard in you no more. And the light of the lamp will shine on you no more. And the voice of the bridegroom and the bride will be heard in you no more. And your merchants, who were the great ones of the earth, and all the nations that were deceived by your sorcery, no more. And in her was found the blood of the prophets and the saints, and the blood of all those who've been slain on the earth, no more. That is the dread destiny of the world. And that's the background to what we've read this morning. As it ends, something wonderful is going to take place. As the world ends, as the darkness comes to an end, it will give way to light. Above the smoke of ruined Babylon, a scene of ineffable light shines forth. It shines forth from heaven. The silence of the ruins of human life will give way to this loud voice of a great multitude in heaven crying out, Hallelujah! Now, we've been given insights in this book of heaven before. We have heard the songs and the cries of creation, of angels and archangels and of the redeemed. In chapter 4, we had a vision of the majesty of God at the center of heaven, on the throne. In chapter 5, we saw the triumph of the Lamb of God, the Lord Jesus, as he comes straight from the cross via his resurrection and ascension into the throne room of heaven to take the throne there and reign. We saw that this Heavenly One has made us all, that is Jesus' people, all of us kings and priests unto God. And by his grace, Jesus has begun building New Jerusalem, code for the heavenly city. New Jerusalem, which will replace Babylon, this world system. This world system that has been so influenced by the demonic, more than we could possibly know. Read C.S. Lewis and St. Augustine. And in the chapters that follow, we see this vast throng gathered from every nation before God and the Lamb. Even martyrdom only has the effect of delivering God's people into their salvation more quickly. We saw how the witness of the church is destined to be rejected utterly by the world. There's the image of the witnesses dead in the streets and people walking past and rejoicing that at last the church has fallen and failed and is now silenced. That's the imagery. But that imagery of the world's rejoicing over the church's fall in the last days, well, the smile will be on the other side of their face when the church is raised to life and elevated to glory. And what remains is only for the world itself to be dismantled. That's what we read in chapter 18. So now in chapter 19, that moment has arrived. And the redeemed cry out,
Hallelujah. You see how the fall of Babylon flows seamlessly into what follows. After this I heard. After this, I heard what seemed to be the sound of a voice of a great multitude in heaven. Everything's been leading up to this moment. This is what we're all waiting for and expecting. And so the transition goes from the fall of Babylon to the joy of heaven. Now, this word hallelujah is used four times in the section that we've read this morning. In the first instance, hallelujah is a song of salvation. It's a song of salvation. The word hallelujah itself, hallel, means praise, and Yah is the shortened form of the name, the personal, private name of God Himself. We actually don't know how to pronounce that name, but this Yah is an abbreviation that we put on it. So it's as if this supreme note of praise has been being held back until this moment. It's as if the whole of the church has repressed its feelings, its true emotions, throughout that long, uncertain period of our pilgrimage throughout time, until world's end, with all the uncertainty and the strife that goes with it. You know, there's a reason why Babylon is selected as a picture of the world, because Israel was taken into exile in Babylon. And when they were in exile in Babylon, they found out how hard it is to live in a foreign country, in a foreign land, with different religions, different laws, different rules. And they would often find themselves bemoaning the fact that they were no longer back in Israel. You have one of the Psalms of which the psalmist sits down by the rivers of Babylon and he says, he weeps when he remembers Zion, and he asks himself the question, how can we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? But now Babylon has fallen. The tyrants have been toppled. The wicked world system has ended. How can we keep from singing hallelujah? Now, what is the first thing then that comes to mind when they sing their hallelujah? Notice it comes immediately. Salvation, they say. Salvation belongs to our God, they sing. That is the great thing that God has done throughout history, that God has been promising to do right throughout the Old Testament, until God Himself comes as our Savior. Jesus, Yeshua, the Lord, the Savior, comes, until He walks onto the stage. And He comes to achieve a victory on our part. He comes to deliver us from our own sin and from the world of sin. And by His death and resurrection, and by His victory at Calvary, He enables us to shout, hallelujah, salvation belongs to our God. St. Augustine said that hallelujah is the connecting link between the worship of the church on earth and the worship of the church in heaven. And here we have the entire assembly of the saints, joined by the angels at the end of history in heaven, joining their voices in praise of God for deposing Babylon, for demonstrating His power, and for delivering His people. And for all of that, God deserves the glory. His judgments, verse 2, are true and just. While they were living below, His people had experienced injustice and lies. They'd been slandered by their enemies. They themselves had to learn how to resist the corrupting power of the world system. And behind that kind of conflict with a culture and a way of life and so on, there is the adversary, the devil, who is our real enemy. He who is a murderer from the beginning. He who is the accuser of the brothers and sisters. Well, in stark contrast to the world's justice and judgment of us, God's judgments are true and just. And he has done what he said he would always do. He has avenged on her, that is the Babylon, the blood of his servants. Every servant of God's who has been corrupted or been seduced into sin by Babylon, every servant of God who has been shamed into denying their faith in Babylon, every servant of God who's been maligned, condemned, criticized, and canceled by Babylon, God has acted and avenged the blood of his servants. Every child of God who has been murdered, slain for their faith, God acts on their part. She who brought the whole world into moral ruin, who deceived so many, who led so many astray, now lies in ruins, ruins. God has been patient with her. God has sent his witnesses into Babylon. Today, as we sit in church, the name of God and the name of Christ are being proclaimed on every continent on this earth. God has been patient. The world has heard. And today is still hearing. Not only that, but God has been feeding them, providing for them, giving them heat and cool and cars and homes and airplanes, the fine things of life as well as the basics of life. God's been giving them that all this time. And they neither thanked him nor did they glorify him. Instead, she has cultivated the universal worship of Antichrist and applauded the universal applause at the death of God's witnesses, and has shown indubitably that secular pagan world is both guilty and irreclaimable. She rejected God's law, disfigured God's image bearers, and hardened her heart. That is what we have been saved from. And so the first hallelujah is a song of praise, a song of salvation, rather. Secondly, the second hallelujah, verse 3, is a shout of victory. Hallelujah! The smoke from her goes up forever and ever. Now, first reading that, you might think that's a bit ghoulish, a bit macabre. But think about this. The fall of Babylon has brought an end to a number of things. It's brought an end to commerce and trade, as we saw. It's brought again to an end the normal things of life, like being married and so forth. It's brought all that to an end, but it's also brought an end to international strife, corporate malfeasance, all forms of abuse, the end of sex trafficking and porn and murder and violence and baby killing. It's brought all of that to an end, all of that. So in never-ending love, the church praises the Lord for his judgments. You know, there are psalms that begin with hallelujah. If you read the book of Psalms as a whole, that'll take you about 10 minutes. You get to the end of the book of Psalms, towards the end, you'll find that the use of the word hallelujah, praise the Lord, is intensified the nearer towards the end of the book of Psalms, until you get to the very last psalm, when the people of God are in heaven, and it's all hallelujah, and it's all praise, and there's no enmity, there's no problems now, because the people of God have arrived home at last. But in those psalms, beginning around about 90, and going intensifying towards the end, they say their hallelujahs when they think about God supreme over the nations and majestic in the heavens. When they're reminded that he rules over the forces of nature and that he has power to destroy the wicked. When they think of the fact that he is able to rescue the oppressed and to raise the poor from the dust and to right his people's wrongs, they're praising God because God has heard them. There are times, you see, there are times when we see so much injustice and evil in the world, sometimes we're a bit angry at God when we pray to God and we say, why don't you put things right? Are you not listening to our prayers? Are you not hearing our anguish? Why don't you act? The message of the Bible is that God will be a friend to truth, that God will act. He will act on behalf of his people. He will cast down evil. He will justify his people. He will silence his critics. And we will yet say, now the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. That day will come. And there will be a shout of victory on that day. Hallelujah. Well, the third hallelujah is a summons to praise. A summons to praise. You notice that this hallelujah is sung by the 24 elders and the four living creatures. They represent, the 24 elders, the totality of the church, the 12 patriarchs of Israel, the 12 apostles of the Lamb, the entirety of the believing church from the Old and the New Covenant are represented by these heavenly beings, these 24 elders. The four living creatures represent the living creatures that God has made from the whole universe. And their presence in the throne room of heaven in chapter 4, for example, where the 24 elders fall down before him who's seated on the throne and they worship him who lives forever and ever, and they sing, "Worthy are you, O Lord our God." These are the beings, creatures, 24 elders and the living creatures, who are now shouting their Amen, Hallelujah. Now, what does Amen mean? People say Amen at the end of prayers. Sometimes people will put some good news on Twitter and somebody will respond. Somebody who's, kind of literate and literally like myself, with one word, Amen. Because I'm lazy. Could write a sentence, but Amen says it all. It's great, great news. Praise the Lord. Amen agrees with statements already made by other worshipers. Somebody says something we agree with, not 10th, but other places, and they shout out, Amen. Amen is a liturgical word by which creatures express their trust in God. Whereas the word hallelujah expresses the worship that is due to this one God who is holy and true. And so we find all nature here, all nature and all the church engaged in a statement of faith, Amen, and an act of worship, hallelujah. Well, there's this great thing. And suddenly there's a voice that comes from heaven. And this voice from heaven is not talking to the people who are in heaven after the end of the world. This voice is actually addressed into the present. So to today, every today until Jesus comes. It's saying this, from the voice came from the throne saying, praise our God, all you his servants, you who fear him, small and great. This is God's word for you today. This is your to-do list for today. Here it is. Praise our God, all you his servants. It's a summons to worship and praise him at this moment in anticipation of that final day. Doesn't matter your age or stage. Doesn't matter your intellectual or mental capacity, your social or your ecclesial standing, or your stage of maturity in as a Christian. All of us are included in the summons. All of us are capable by the Spirit or in the Spirit of being part of the worship and praise of God. You know, one of the best commentators in the book of Revelation is the Venerable Bede, a medieval minister. And he writes this: when he commands that this be done and then mentions that it has been done, he is indicating the approved praise of his elect. It says small and great because to be small in natural abilities does not matter if one's heart and tongue are full of the praise of the Lord. And he picks up the verse from Psalm 115. He will bless them that fear the Lord, both small and great. This hallelujah then is a summons to praise. Well, then the fourth hallelujah is a sound like thunder, Look at verse 6. Then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude. This multitude are going to be the collective praises of the universal church, assembled like the din of a vast multitude, the roar of a cataract, the violent peal of loud thunder. The Venerable Bede again: the great voice of those singing indicates the great devotion of the heart. By the manifold repetition of praise, the voice rejoices in the destruction of the wicked and in the eternal glory of the Lord and of those who are His. So this hymn then picks up a theme already introduced in chapter 11. In chapter 11, we had the last trumpet sound. And when it sounded, there were voices in chapter 11, verse 15, loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of His Christ, and He shall reign forever and ever. Now in chapter 19, the whole host of heaven, the whole number of the elect, join in the hallelujah chorus. Chapter 11 prepared us for this. When we come to the human story, when the trial comes for rewarding your servants, the prophets and the saints, for destroying the destroyers of the earth. That time for destroying the destroyers of the earth, that's the way God looks at Babylon. That's the way God looks at our cultural, political overlords. They are destroyers. They are destroyers of the earth. And one day they will be destroyed. But it's also a day for rewarding your servants. And in chapter 19, we're taken further as we find God's servants rewarded by this invitation to the wedding we were made for. Now, the invitation arises out of the total sovereignty of God. Do you see that? Salvation: for the Lord our God, the Almighty reigns. He is almighty and He reigns. All-powerful, all-reigning over all. It isn't the doom of Babylon for which the church gives thanks to God. The church is giving thanks to God for the sequel. Babylon's ended, done with. The world system has broken down for the very last time, and it is now extinct. Why are they praising? They're praising for what takes its place. The setting up of the kingdom. This is the answer to the church's prayer that we pray here. Every week we pray this: Thy kingdom come. Now the world power has fallen in order that that spiritual and eternal kingdom might take its place. Everything about this world order, its politics, its culture, its science, technology, and its people, everything is provisional and passing and will end. But for the church, that's their end is the beginning. You see, put it like this: the story of the church is the story of a people or a community on its way to Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is our destiny. He is our goal. He is our end towards whom we are moving. Yes, we trust in Jesus now, but we're moving towards him in person, his coming, his glory, his kingdom, him. And so in verse 7, they say, "Let us rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready." This is the marriage we were made for. The marriage supper of the Lamb will occur when the church is complete and is united finally with its Lord in the heavenly kingdom. And this imagery of the bride and the bridegroom is one that you find throughout the Holy Scripture. The bride, the mother, is God's church. Jesus very, very quickly in his ministry identifies himself as the bridegroom. John tells us the first thing Jesus did would go to a wedding. And that's the wedding at which he turned 500 gallons of water into 500 gallons of the finest Chateauneuf du Pape. Jesus is the one who said the kingdom of heaven can be compared to a king who gave a marriage feast for his son. The old language of the Old Testament, God comes to Israel and says, "I will betroth you to me in faithfulness so that you shall know the Lord." Isaiah says, "For the Lord God has called you like a wife." In Psalm 45, we have a description of the Messiah, Jesus, as the Son of God, whose throne is forever and ever, who comes to meet his bride, who enters all dressed up with joy and gladness, enters the palace of the king to be received by her divine lover. And all this language is taken up as prophecy of the coming king and his people. Paul writes to the Corinthians, "I betrothed you to one husband to present you as a pure virgin to Christ." So this language is biblical language. And it's in this context then that Jesus spoke of a wedding feast where those who were invited refused to come. The invitations went out to the people who wanted to come, and they were turned down. All of them turned down. And so Jesus says the host of that wedding sent out his servants and said, "Just go out into the highways and the byways, get the people nobody's inviting to weddings and get them to come." It's an image, of course, of the Gentiles being gathered into the kingdom of God. So this language then is biblical language. The book of Revelation has three female figures: the mother, the prostitute, and the bride. The first and the third, the mother and the bride, represent the church in two different aspects of her life. The church is our mother, Paul says in Galatians. We're baptized into her. She nourishes us, cherishes us, teaches us, protects us. Nobody can have God as their father who doesn't have the church as their mother, said St. Augustine. And the bride, that is, she belongs to Christ. From heaven he came and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought her, and for her life he died. The harlot, the prostitute, the world system. The world system is the church's greatest rival and enemy. See, if we're betrothed to Jesus, if as a church we belong to him, when we listen to other voices and heed them, when we adopt other values, when we are tempted to go along with the notions and the current ideas of our culture, what are we doing? We are being unfaithful to Christ. We're being unfaithful to him who loved us oh so well. When we adopt as a priority in our life, and I choose my words carefully here, as the priority of our life, the world's culture, politics, commerce, if those are our priorities, then we've been unfaithful to Jesus. This world is not a friend to God. And yet the amazing thing is this, that Babylon, for all its ungodliness and oppression and temptation, is the fire which God ultimately uses to refine our faith and to prepare us to enter the heavenly city. As we resist its attractions, and it is attractive, as we resist her temptations, and they are temptations, as we learn to build up, flex the muscles of our soul, as it were, by resisting those things. Now, that doesn't mean not appreciating the good things that come out of the world. We spent some time talking about that last week. There are good things. We depend on the world for our food and our clothes and cars and airplanes and holidays and so on, all of these things. But they don't have our heart. That's the key. Greg Beale puts it like this: the fire ultimately used of God to refine the saints' faith is to prepare them to enter the heavenly city. And you notice in verse 8, it says this: it was granted to her to clothe herself with white linen, pure and bright. The word granted means gifted. It's a word that gives us the word grace. This is a gift of grace God gives to her. He gives her to the grace of clothing her with the righteousness of Jesus Christ. That's how she is justified and is able to have access to God in the first place. But there's another gift that comes to the church, and that is the gift of the Holy Spirit, by which the church is enabled to produce good works. Ephesians 2, we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. And that's particularly what's referred to here. Do you notice? The fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. These are not the deeds that justify them, but these are the deeds that beautify them on that day. That beautify them. The believer's good works are wrought in them by the Spirit. Great verse. If Philippians chapter 2, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do his good pleasure. Okay, I'm going to wind it up. Back in chapter 14, we heard these words: blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. From now on, they may rest from their labors. Robert Carl Witham has died, and he has entered into his rest. You've loved ones who have died. My parents have gone these many years, and they have entered into their rest with the Lord. What death opens up to the believer is that they go to be with Christ, which is by far the best, and they have rest from their labors. But at the end of the age, things are ratcheted up at the end of the age. Heaven's rest ripens into high festivity, gears up to active celebration. Now look what is said: blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Jesus said, I tell you, many will come from east and west to recline at table with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. There's going to be a celebration, a party. Don't know how long it's going to last. It's going to last a long, long time in the kingdom. And the angel says to John, write that down. I want my people to hear this. Write that down. Because my people, my believing people, are the ones who've been invited to the wedding feast. My believing people are those who've been enabled to receive the invitation and to claim it as their own. And if you're not a Christian here today, this is written down so you hear this. This is what the destiny of the world is. This is your destiny. Whether you're there at the end of history or whether you die, you need to know how to be sure that your destiny is secure. This is how it's secured. You ask for the grace to receive this invitation that God is giving to you. This invitation to the marriage feast, to the celebration beyond all celebrations. The marriage we were made for will begin. And the angel emphasizes, these are the true words of God. And here's a little bit of testimony to the authenticity of this incident. John, he hears this. He's overwhelmed by this brilliant angel and what the angel's been saying. He's overwhelmed by it all. And he begins by falling at his feet to worship him. He's heard the word of God through this creature, this being. He puts the word of God and the creature together in his head. It's so overwhelming and so on, that he goes to worship this creature. And immediately the angel says, you better not do that. You cannot do that. Worship God. And he ends by telling us that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. The whole Bible is a testament to Jesus. And the whole business of the angels is to testify to Jesus. And the whole business of your life and mine and the life of our church is to bear witness to Jesus. Let's pray. Lord, we pray that by your great grace, we might this morning embrace him who loves us oh so well, the Lord Jesus. That you would hasten that day when faith turns to sight, when the darkness is lifted, and we see the glorious brightness of the heavenly place. And we're all together in one place at one time to see Jesus, the Lamb of God. In his strong name we pray. Amen.
Work on your singing. The volume could go up a bit. Next time, lift up your heads and receive the benediction. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all evermore.